It's so good to see all of you here. And this is the second lesson in the second book. Okay, so this one in the psychological area of life is the one on focus. And I don't know about you, but I have really been challenged in this area this week. Okay, how about you? Focus. Yeah, it seems like everything that can wants to get us off track, or I can really speak for me. I know it's been one thing after the other, feel bombarded. Anyway, we worked really hard today to stay focused, and I'm glad. I feel like God has done that. Our key verse tonight is in Romans 12:2. It says, "Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. Then you will know what God wants you to do, and you will know how good and pleasing and perfect His will really is." In the last area of life, the spiritual, we talked about, and I brought out my little transformer friend. He's in here. And I want you to see that even though this is a toy, this is exactly what I'm trying to tell you about who God made you to be in Him. And see, we have the old man. He looks pretty bad in there. And we all were born into sin. Given a choice, even a two-year-old, when they're just a little kid, they just start to walk. And yet they know they're not supposed to touch the remote. And what do? You say, "Give me the remote." They run the other way. Okay? We do not have a natural bent to be good. We actually have a natural bent to be evil. Okay, and of course, the first book was all about that, is where does that nature, that sin nature, come from? And it does not come from God. It comes from the master of perversion, the enemy. Okay, and so we have this in us. But when we bring Christ into our life, okay, everything changes. And that's where we become a new creation, made for what God wanted us to do. I said, this was our Maserati. We're going to take a journey now. The old man, the old is gone. The new has come. But we will still have the old man inside that God will be working on. And that's our journey, okay? So when we look at a verse like this in Romans 12:2, he says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. Stop looking around and trying to fit in the world, okay? This is what that's about. You know, I remember, you know, just as a young girl, even in kindergarten, I wanted to dress like the other kids did. I wanted, you know, you all know this. You go to school and you've got to have like the latest sneakers or the latest jeans because you don't want to stand out, which is totally opposite, really, of what God wants to do with you, because He made you with a plan and a purpose. And if it's to stand out in a crowd for Him, He's going to let you stand out and get used to it. He won't do that with everybody. He's got a different plan and a purpose for everyone. But we will naturally, in our flesh, go against what God really purposes for our lives. It's amazing to see this. So we are going to look in this chapter, we're going to be looking at how much your thinking affects how you feel. Because see, we see these things, we react with it, and then all of a sudden we either feel bad about ourselves or we feel better about ourselves. And so we have these emotional ups and downs. Our feelings will reveal where we are focused. Okay, now it's very important for you to understand the part that feelings play in your life. When we don't know what we, or when we actually do life according to our feelings, you can tell someone who does live according to their feelings because their life is like an emotional roller coaster. Okay? And the best way I can explain it here is like, do you have a thermostat in your house? Okay. And we just had a little bit of a snap of cold weather in the midst of having some wonderful warm weather, right? Okay, so I'm sure that some of you have been looking at that thermostat. And the thing about it is you can be comfortable in your house and you could look outside and think that it's going to be the same temperature out there, right? And yet what does it reveal? Many times your thermostat is just revealing what the, and it should just reveal what the temperature is inside the house, not necessarily what it is outside the house. And our feelings are a lot like that. We will think things that make us afraid. And we'll think that everything out there is to be feared. Or we'll do the opposite. We'll think we'll just be in our own little place of nirvana, and we just think that everything's great and good, and then we go out and it's a really harsh world. Okay, and so that's what feelings, the part that feelings play in your life, is a lot just like being a thermostat. It's supposed to tell you and reveal to you where you're at, what the temperature is. It is not in any way, the feelings are not where you're supposed to head. You're not supposed to be living according to your feelings. You're just supposed to take those feelings and then walk according to God's word with those feelings. So in order to get to that, we're going to be working through this lesson tonight. See, when God is in me, my spirit is alive. And so what that means is now I know I have a new identity in Christ. I am accepted and I am blameless in his sight. His identity on me is the only true identity. Now, maybe you didn't have, from the beginning, parents that spoke who you were to you. Very few of us, I think, did. There's, you know, we need to be more intentional like that. If you've got young children and you're teaching them, then they need to know what God says about them is the truest thing for them. That no matter what somebody says to them or how hurtful the world is, that God still has the absolute truth. And so in your spirit, you have to realize that you are accepted. Whoops. Didn't get much out of that one tonight. Accepted and blameless. Now, how many of you have told yourself that you're blameless? Unless you know where the Bible says you are blameless, you probably haven't done it. Anybody know where it says that? Can you tell me right away? Okay, it's Ephesians. Yeah, first chapter in Ephesians tells you that. Romans 5:16 says, we have this free gift of being accepted by God, even though we are guilty of many sins. This is the gift that God gave us through Jesus Christ. God also says you're blameless. So Jesus bore your punishment for sin and rebellion against God, and you are chosen, holy, and without guilt. And then in Ephesians 1, this is where I'm referring to, you receive, he says, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. And you have a half a sheet of paper that your leader at your table is going to give you. And all I have done is copy it straight out of the Bible, put it on a piece of paper. And yeah, okay. Somebody help them over there. And so I've just copied this right out of a Bible, okay? And the blanks there are for your name. So I want you to take pen, pencil, whatever you've got right now, and I want you to put it in each one of those blanks, and we're going to read that together. See, we receive information through our senses. We hear and we see. And so sometimes just a simple exercise like this really helps us see where we are in the Bible. Believe it or not, in my own Bible, I've actually crossed out all the personal pronouns in that section of scripture, and I put my name over them so that whenever I read it in my Bible, where it says us or we, I have it Linda. Linda, me. Okay. So let's take a minute. Did you all get your names written on there? Because I want us all to read this together. Okay? Ephesians 1, verses 3 to 8. Let's begin. Praise be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ for giving me, through Christ, every spiritual benefit as a citizen of heaven. For consider what he has done. Before the foundation of the earth, he chose Linda to be in Christ, his child, holy and blameless in his sight. He planned in his love that Linda should be adopted as his own child through Jesus Christ. This was his will and pleasure that Linda might praise the glorious generosity of his grace, which he granted to me in his beloved. It is through him, at the cost of his own blood, that Linda is redeemed, freely forgiven, through that free and generous grace which has overflowed into Linda's life and given Linda all wisdom and insight. Wow! That's who you are. I bet you haven't talked to yourself that nice in ages. Okay, and I want you to take it right out of the Holy Scriptures and own it. Own it. When you accuse yourself, you are doing the work of the enemy. Stop partnering with him. Partner with God. This is just the beginning. Taste it. See it, that this is who God wants you to be. It's who he already made you to be. He's just trying to rework your brain. I'll never forget, I was really young, and I loved to read. In fact, I was one of those kids who the minute I learned to read, I would take a flashlight to bed, and I would read under the covers. My mom was always after me. She'd always know. She'd come in and she'd grab that flashlight away from me and say, go to sleep, you have to go to bed. And I just loved to read. I do. There were whole periods of my life where I had like 5 books going at the same time. I mean, I just really do. Was a voracious reader, still love to read. Love to learn, okay? But there was something that happened along the way, and it was about fourth grade. And all of a sudden, I got a note sent home from school that said, I don't know what's wrong, but Linda just doesn't seem to be doing as well in school. And I thought I was fine, so I didn't know what that note said. But long story short, we had to go to an optometrist. Okay. So in that, I would find out that, wow, I had a very progressive kind of condition with my eyes that I would definitely need glasses. And so over those next couple years, they got worse and worse. And my parents were worried. I could tell they were like, oh, we gotta take her in again. And you know, and then of course they were always taking the flashlight out of my hand, and I wasn't too happy either. I just still loved to read. And so they had gotten me a special light and thought it might make it easier on my eyes. But what ended up happening was by the time I was 11, which is still really young, they had just really been experimenting with contact lenses. And so my doctor said, I usually don't like to prescribe these to children. He said, but because of the way that my eye was growing and shaped, he said it might hold it back, almost like a brace on the eye. And of course, back then we didn't have the comfortable lenses we have now. They were like pieces of plastic in my eyes. And so, believe it or not, though, I was desperate enough to learn how to wear them way back when. okay? And I still don't have great eyes, so I have to wear my contact lenses. But I will tell you that what it did for me, it opened up a whole new world. Because where I thought were just bunches of green on trees, I found out there were beautiful little leaves. And they had like little veins in them. And I was like so excited about all the details that I was seeing in my life. It just like woke up my eyes. And so I have loved wearing contact lenses more than glasses, because the glasses have the space between my eye in it. And with my condition that I have, I still walk into door jams if I have my glasses on. I don't have very good perspective, so I keep my contacts in a lot. Okay, but I'm saying that because this is the same kind of thing, that when you have good focus and you can see clearly, the old way of thinking, the old fuzzy thought patterns fall away. And that's where we have to go together. Because, you know, we haven't, you know, I grew up in church, and yet I had a lot of faulty thinking. I call it stinking thinking. I've heard some of you guys repeat that now. I still do. I call it stinking thinking because it really, you know, if you're just one degree off, you're going to be wrong. Just one degree. Okay, so it's really important that we get sound thinking in this. So when you've set your mind and your thoughts on things in this world, you're actually going to be playing to the negative in this world. Because I'm telling you here, the true north is still God. God always has been, he always will be. He made you. He knows you better than you know yourself. You may think you know yourself, but I bet you can even think of things that happened and you go, wow, okay. I know I was wrong on that. And see, God allows those things to come into our life so we don't trust in ourselves, so we trust in something bigger than ourselves. And what happens if we continue to trust in the world, then this is how distorted our thinking's going to be. So you have to understand this now to get to where we need to go. So the world will tell you that you are how you appear. Appearance. This happens, I think I left a letter out, sorry. Our appearance. You're judged all the time on how you look, what you're wearing, how fit you are. People don't, they make, you know, you never, you've heard that expression, you never get a chance to make, or you never get a second chance to make a first impression. Okay? And a lot of people are big on that. They just set everything by that. But that isn't how God works. In fact, God goes way out of his way in stories. One of my favorite earliest stories is when he told Jesse, the father of 12 sons, that he was going to have a son that would be the king of Israel. And of course, he brought all of his sons to parade by the prophet. And that prophet, Samuel, at the time was, he goes, well, it must be the firstborn, you know? And of course, and God didn't tell him it was. So he went down the whole line. He says, hey, this is all your sons? He goes, it isn't any of these guys. And they go, well, there's one more, but he's out tending sheep. Can't be him. What'd he say? Go get him. And the minute he brought that little shepherd boy in and he placed his hand on his head, it says he didn't even look anything like a chosen king. And yet God knew that he had purposed in that young man's life to lead a whole country. And of course, we love to read the stories of David through the Bible, but there's so many where God knows you. He's got a plan and a purpose for your life. And if you have never tapped into that, then you're wandering. And maybe that's part of your journey right now. You're wandering. You don't know what you're supposed to do with your life. Somewhere along the way, you missed the direction that God was taking you. And so it's never too late to stop and do an honest appraisal of where you're at. And that's what I hope, if anything, that you can start to see, is that how the world thinks is going to be very different than how God thinks. See, if you look at the world and you want their approval, then you agree with the world and you place just as much importance on what the world does on your appearance than you agree with the world. And see, when you agree with the world, you're going against God's whole thought process. Can you see that? Okay, it happens for all of us. What happens is when we don't match what the world thinks we should, then this thing called insecurity becomes part of our life. And of course, if it does, it manifests itself in many, many ways. Okay? See, the world may say one way, if you don't look like what's current and on the magazines, then what happens is this conflict in between your soul and your body manifests itself in insecurity. The world also tells you and gives you kudos and awards for your abilities. Now, can all of you play piano like Tom? Of course we can't. We wish we could, right? No, we all have different abilities, okay? But because you can't, that doesn't make you inadequate. And yet, maybe for some of you, if you see someone that does something and you can't quite do it as well as they can, then what you do is you feel, inadequate. And so you feel less than other people. You always think, it's amazing this dynamic that happens. We compare ourselves, and I don't know why we do it, but you're all going to know you do it. You're going to compare yourself for how someone else looks on the outside. But you're going to compare yourself on how you are on the inside. Isn't that crazy? Because you know yourself best. So you're going to compare your flawed self with someone else's perfect veneer. Do you see? We do this all the time. And usually we always end up being the loser. Okay. Or if you really have a real healthy ego, then you're going to be the winner. I don't know. Either one. Okay, you pick. But I want you to see that that's what we do. Instead of just accepting who we are and who God made us to be with our, how we look, what our abilities are, okay? And of course, there's another area that we like to compare ourselves, and that's with actions. Okay, and sometimes actions are behaviors, okay? And really, when you look at that, actions and what that breeds in us is usually our mistakes, where we went wrong. It's the hole we dig for ourselves. It's that hole that we line with guilt and shame. And so and it's also drawn up from our past. Okay, it's not present usually. Sometimes it is, you know you blew it right away. But most of the time it's past. You're bringing in your past. And so this is the guilt or the shame. And this is how we live. This is why so many of you don't sleep at night. It's why you have issues with digestion. bowel symptoms, IBS. This is symbolizes that conflict you have between your body and your soul. And see, we have this all the time. We just aren't dissecting it like we are right now. See, this is where disorders come out, eating disorders come out of this. You know, deep-seated depressions, all of this comes out when we are taking cues from the world instead of from God. Now, hang in there with me. You see, the world applauds us when we do what they want us to do. See, they do. And so if you are addicted to approval of other people, you're gonna really struggle right now, okay? Because you're not, it's not gonna be enough for you to just agree with God on how you look and your gene pool and the family you were born into. It's not enough for you, your abilities that you have. It's not enough. You want more. Or your actions. It's not enough to know God forgave you. He's the God that gives you second, third, 3,000 chances to move into his steps and to walk with him. You see, when you are walking with him, then in your spirit, okay, you are here. You are feeling accepted and blameless. So what that does is that negates this. It says, well, I know that's what the world says I am, but that's not who I am. Who I really am is, you got the sheep, holy, chosen, blessed, adopted, blameless, forgiven. I have all wisdom and insight. Guys, that's not just words. That's God's truth. It's God's gift to you. See, this is where the rubber meets the road. This is not the kind of teaching that you come in, you sit down, you're going to be here for a couple hours, and then you go out and just live like you always did. There's a requirement here. And it's not from me. I don't check your homework. You know I don't. Okay. Because I know who's going to burn this into your soul. It's going to be God. He's going to give you hope tonight. Somehow he is, because it's going to be through his word. I know that. He's going to help show you that the things that are truest in your spirit are gifts from God. The sad thing is, it's easier to go the way of the world. It's the inertia. It's the school of fish all going in the same direction. And you're going against the tide. One of my daughter's favorite posters in her room. I'd love to get one now. We don't even know what happened to it, but I remember her recalling it. And she goes, Mom, do you know what happened to that poster? And I said, I have no idea, honey, but it was a school of silverfish. And they were all going in one direction, but there was one in the middle of the school of fish that was going the other direction. It was a rainbow fish. And she goes, that was me. She goes, I would look at that all the time and know I was that rainbow fish. Because I really felt like everybody in school was gone against what you were teaching me and what I was learning. And she goes, but I just hung on because I was that rainbow fish going the other direction. It's the little things, guys, you have to hold on to. See, if you have a tendency to believe what you feel as opposed to what God says about you, you're going to be very frustrated. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I know they're here. You're here. I didn't ask for the hands. See, the life that God has for you will never become your living experience if your mind is set on this flesh. This is the battle that's gone on inside the Maserati. I know it. But I also know that God has charge of your journey and your acceleration and all that he needs to do with you if you let him. You don't have to let that old man drive. You need to let God drive. We've talked about this before. You have to get out of the driver's seat. Let God do the driving. See, your mind can either be set on the world or God. The spirit of the flesh, truth or lies. You are not a puppet. You decide. God's given you a free will. He's a perfect gentleman. He will not make you do anything that you don't want to do. See, when your mind is focused on the world, your soul will experience wrong thinking, wrong choices, and negative emotions. God worked on me in this area through cancer. When my husband, who was just 45, we didn't know why he was having a lot of back pain. And, you know, here we were. We'd already amazingly made it through the murder of a child. Our marriage took a hard hit. But here we were. We had survived that. And we were actually off at school training. And he comes down with a lump on the side of his neck and goes and gets checked out. And before we know it, through a whole series of events, he comes home and he says, or he comes back to the office and he said, "I'm full of lymphoma." I didn't even know what lymphoma was. I just knew it was cancer. And as we tried to process what that meant, I thought to myself, this just can't be. What else? You know, what did we do wrong? You know? And it's funny how you turn on yourself right away. You know, and the thing is, we had a homestead up in the mountains. We canned our own food. We didn't use artificial anything. We did a whole organic everything. And I said, the only thing my husband was addicted to was spring water. He had put in our own spring. We didn't have really any. We had just clean living. And here he comes down with cancer. And so at first, you know, I'm thinking, okay, well, God, you're going to heal him. I just know you are. You can do this. You didn't take us through the death of our child to leave us now. We are going to make it through. And we had, you know, we had people praying for us. Our elders prayed for us. We did everything we thought we should. And yet in that time frame, when he was actually, when he was diagnosed, he was moving quickly into fourth stage cancer. Okay. Two little kids, 5 and 9, okay, or 5 and 10 by that time. And you just take one step in front of the other and keep both eyes on God. I can remember that like it was yesterday. Believe it or not, I'll go back in my mind many a time because I never felt so close to God in those months that would pass. And let me tell you, I want to tell you how God used my journey with him at this time to teach me, number one, how to hear him. Do you know that the Bible says you should be hearing from God? The verse, John 10:27, listen. He says, "My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me." John 10:27. That's what it says. "My sheep hear my voice." You know, we talked about the shepherd, how if you have a wayward lamb, how he would break their leg and hold them close. I felt like that broken lamb. I know my husband felt like that broken lamb. And so we didn't dare. We just walked close to God. We really everything, we really just bathed our lives in what he was doing. We trusted that he would somehow heal Bill. Okay, we trusted him for that healing. I learned in that time frame to walk in step with the Spirit. God provided a way for me when I would take the kids to school and I would walk 3 miles on the beach. It's really neat. And in that time that I would spend walking, I would hear from God. Sometimes he would drop a song into my spirit. I bet he does that with some of you and you just blow that off. But no, he would give me a song, he would give me lyrics. He would speak through, I would hear another, you know, maybe a voice of the pastor would go through what, you know, what the pastor was saying that Sunday, and I couldn't get it out of my head. He'd be talking to me that way. Sometimes I really would just hear from him, telling me, do the next thing, just do the next thing. Go home and do your laundry. Just do the next thing. Every time I'd wake up and I'd think, is this the day? And see, I was starting to realize, wow, I'm waking up on the negative because I'm thinking, is he going to die today? And God really convicted me of that in these walks and says, no, let this be the day that you have the most fun. And so we started to just change our mindset. To instead of waiting for him to die, we started to make something great happen in the midst of it. Do you see? We started to make memories. We just didn't make long-range plans, okay? And part of seasons like this, God is teaching you how to take one step and put it in front of the other and keep both eyes on him. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I know there are people in this room in this kind of season right now. And I want to affirm you in this season because God has you where you are on purpose. See, he's not a random God. He's a God of design. You didn't end up here out of randomness. This God designed this path for you. He designed who you're with and what you're doing for his good. See? And too many times we want the struggle to end right away. Hey, I was there. I wanted him healed and I wanted it done now. I'd hold my Bible out there and go, by your stripes, he is healed. You are going to do this. I'm sure he got a lot of comic relief from me. But I took him at his word and he knew that. It was just simple faith. I was afraid. I didn't know how I'd live without him. We'd been married 24 years at that point. We'd been through hell and back. I did not ever expect to bury a 46-year-old man who'd never been sick a day in his life. I was scared. I didn't know how God would provide. Bill didn't leave any life insurance. He didn't have medical insurance. We'd gone through the savings on alternative medicine cures to try and get that. So, I mean, I had every reason to be afraid. You would go, whoa, Linda, wait a minute. Yeah, you didn't? No, I didn't, really. I've often told people I had the gift of starting over with two precious children. Okay, I did. And I'm here today to tell you that, okay? You can't fake it. See, Philippians 2:13 says, for God is working in you, giving you the desire to obey him and the power to do what pleases him. See, you get to a part where you realize it is life and death. We are put here to live well, to glorify God, and to die well, accomplishing his mission for us. See, the world will tell you a different story. I don't know what your world has told you, but I bet if during break you shared some of that with your table, I think that would be good. If you could tell me, what's your world tell you your life should be right now? Okay, because God is saying something very different. And until we see clearly, until we put those lenses in and really see God 2020, we're either going to be up and down on this roller coaster ride, or we're going to be soul sick. We're not going to be at peace. And yet that's where we need to be. Because see, if we look this way, then what happens is we actually are confident, right? We're going to trust in what he is going to say to us. We're going to know we're complete. He's got us right in his hand. And he has totally forgiven us anything from our past. You know, there's nothing that he can't forgive. That's not what your brain is telling you. You think somewhere along the line that you've been the worst sinner. And I'm telling you, no, you haven't. First of all, I think that even Paul says, he goes, I'm the chiefest of sinners, is what he says. I think we all get to a point where we read that scripture and we go, no, I'm the chiefest of sinners. Because you died for me. You didn't deserve to die. I did. And see, when we start to realize what he paid for us to be this free, it starts to sharpen your eyesight into the unseen. You know, before, just to sort of way pull this together, was before Bill died, up to that point, he'd been my life. And I got to thinking, gosh, if he's going to get to heaven before me, I'm going to be left on my own with these kids, and Lord, I'm going to have to answer on my own. And even in that amazing time, what he was doing was he was separating us. I know he was now. And preparing me to only listen to him. Do you see? I know that's for many of you that think you have to be completed in someone else. See, he was teaching me, no, Linda, you stand on your own. You answer for what you have to do. Yes, Bill's your husband. I know you love him. But ultimately, he will answer for what he has done, and you will answer for what you have done. I started to look differently at the God that knew me best. You see, he knows you better than you know yourself. Isn't that amazing? He knows what he designed you for. At that point in my life, I had no idea that God had designed me to do all that I do today. I'd probably run. Okay. But he would gradually rebuild me and reconstruct me in a way where he would not waste a heartache or a tear. I am nobody different than anybody else here. I know that he wants to do that in your life too. That's who he is. That's his nature. He loves you so much. He gave you life and breath. He gave you the resources that you need. And he may have given you the lack of resources that you need right now to bring you to this place. Do you see? He doesn't waste anything. He's building your trust and your faith in him. He's refining your focus. When I would go walk along the beach, it was amazing. I would just be walking along in the morning, and he'd be putting like crumbs out for me, but they were shark's teeth. But they really were. It was like I just knew. After a while, I thought, at first I thought it was like, this is a fluke. I keep finding these shark's teeth. But after a while, it got to be God's thing with me. He would just, I felt like half the time they were just placed in a line in front of me. I really didn't go looking for them. They were just always right in front of me. And I would pick them up and take them home. And over these years, as God has given me these things, I go back to this time when Bill was actually at this point in his disease. He was actually bedridden. He had been paralyzed on his left side because of the tumors. And so he would say, you know, he'd hear me come in the door and he'd go, how many did you find today? And I'd have a handful and I'd go take it over to him and he'd look at these shark's teeth. And you know, I'll never forget, it was a very special morning and I gave him a handful of them and he goes, oh my goodness. I just was busy tidying up around him and he just kept holding them and he said, you know, Lenny, he said, God has really shown me that he's given these to you to show you that nothing will ever harm you again. He goes, I just know it. He says, it's going to be hard, but nothing's going to harm you. Every time you hold a shark's tooth in your hand, you're just going to know that God's hand is going to keep you from harm. That did a lot for me that day, especially because I was afraid. I was really afraid of living without him. And yet what he did for me was he gave me a blessing to be strong enough to go on. He would die shortly after that. And tonight, I want you all, I brought my little bag of shark's teeth. I want you all to have a shark's tooth. So I want you to remember that. And I don't want you to be afraid. I want you to hold on to it and just know that nothing, no weapon formed against you can prevail when you have God. That's his promise to us. I want you to get ready for your break now. We're going to do that. But I want you to spend some time, get your snack, and then come back to your table and talk about really what is keeping you right now. What are you afraid of? What are you taking in from the world that you really should be trusting God with? Okay? And you don't have to, but I know some of you want to. So, you know, it's good to share with people who care. Okay? Let's take a break now and have some table time. Okay, I heard some good discussion going on during break, so that's great. Philippians 2:13, for God is working in you. For God is working in you.
Amen.
Okay. He's giving you the desire to obey him and the power to do what pleases him. We've presented what you're up against. That's why he says, choose you the way you should go. You have to make a choice. For you that have seen this diagram before, you know this is how we describe us and how God made us. We are a spirit being who has a soul that lives in a body, an earth suit. Okay? This area between them, nothing can separate you except God. Nothing. He'll separate you through death in this area, and he will separate you from him if you are not in love with his son. See, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except through me. That's pretty clear. I didn't make that up. That came straight out of scripture and straight out of Jesus' mouth. He's shown us very clearly that he made you. You are his workmanship. That's one of your new identities. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Only he knows how many hairs are on your head. He knows your heartbeat. He knows the day you'll draw your last breath. Because he loves you. He made you. And he made you with a plan and a purpose. See, believing what God says changes the very way that you feel in your soul. Because, see, God speaks words of wisdom and encouragement to you all the time if you are listening. Now, during break, I passed out those shark's teeth. And I wanted, you know, I know I have, yes, I have found a lot of shark's teeth. But I will tell you that I will never find a shark's teeth on a day that I'm looking for shells. You can't look at the dark and the light at the same time. I had mentioned one time when I spoke that I wanted to, that back in the 80s, they had this little plaque that people would put up in their homes, and it was a strange little wooden plaque that just looked like gibberish if you didn't know how to read it. And see, but if you turn it this way and only look at the light, what does it say? Ah. But see, if you only look at the dark, turn it upside down, you'll never see what it means. Neat, huh? What these are just exercises in focusing. So you have to focus on the light, the truth, things that are good, true, pure, and lovely. That's what you think of. And if your thought life is overtaken with dark world, just, you know, all the bad things that are going to happen, fear. You know, there's just so much news you can actually watch, guys. Just let you know. You're going to have to limit your own self. Nobody will do that for you. God is not going to do that. He's not. You have a chooser. You have a free will. Every single one of you has one. You were born with it. And you can choose to do right or you can choose to do wrong. You can live in the light or you can live in the dark. But the point is, this is where when we, you know, we're actually halfway through the salt, the 12 salt teachings. And I love it that we're really on this middle ground here right now, because this is where your mindset has to be. There is so much in our world competing for your mind. I used to read this paper, and I want to rewrite it because I feel like it's out of date now, so I'm not going to read it to you, but it's about this word busy, and it's an acronym for saying being under Satan's yoke. And so many times the busyness of our world just drowns out the voice of God. Where have you created a spot for you and God? Where do you go to hear him? You know, a lot of people will say, I talk to him every day, Linda. I go, well, glad. When's the last time you actually heard from him? It says, when you say you talk to God every day, yeah. I'm much more interested in whether you hear from God every day. See, when we talk to God, lots of times we're talking at him. We're telling him what we want, what we're going to do, how we're going to take us on this journey, instead of hearing where he's going to take us. I can't tell you how many times, even just coming into work, I'll ask him, Lord, what are we going to do today? And I keep a schedule. But I know that God can interrupt it at any time. I know that there's been too many coincidences. No, I don't believe in them either. They're God incidences that I find myself right in the middle of. They were never planned. They never made it to my day planner. You see, you want to be available to be used by God. He needs to do the driving. He needs to keep your day planner. Where do you go to put that in front of him and say, Lord, you know, this is my schedule this week, but you have your ways, and just help me be flexible. If you change it, I'll be there. Help me not to miss where I need to be. And see, that's what comes in listening for God's voice. I told you, he taught me to do that down on the beach. Maybe you can't do that, okay? Then find a spot that you can hear from God, where you can be still and know that he is God. Now I'm going to challenge you, because I know that if you knew he was coming to your house and he made a date with you, that you'd have a really nice meal prepared for him, and you would have maybe a special tablecloth and bring out the good dishes, and it would be really well set up. And yet, how many of you even have a chair that maybe you meet with him in all the time? Or know where your Bible is in the house? A place where you can run to it if you get an unexpected phone call or bad news. I always challenge people. I said, did you ever, have you made room in your house for God? And I'm not asking in a religious way to set up an altar and to do all that and light candles and do all that. I'm not saying do that. But if it does make you feel closer to him, then there's nothing wrong with that. I don't want to diss it either. I want your heart's cry for him. I want a place where you can go to and know that you're immediately in his presence. I have one of them, it's my garden. Even in the winter, sometimes I'll just sit out there all bundled up and I just feel his presence. It's quiet, the birds sing. They're like the background for his voice. Doesn't have to be that elaborate. It just has to be a spot where you know that your Bible's always there, or a word is always there, or maybe there's the switch for your worship music, but your survival kit is in place. We're talking about your spirit now. If you're walking around with a wounded spirit, what are you doing to help it heal? I bet a lot of you have an emergency kit in your car for if anything happens, or maybe you don't. That's telling too, okay? I'm just saying, how many of you are actually prepared to hear from God or for an emergency or have a place set at the table for him? See, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. It's that thing that you can't put in a box. It transcends miles and space when you know that you are speaking to the lover of your soul. When's the last time you heard from him? See, the input from God is always the same. You're accepted and you're blameless. So what's keeping you away from him? Many times it is this busy, being under Satan's yoke. It's amazing how quickly the minutes fly by when we're on Facebook or Pinterest or watching the news or in front of the TV, and it has no lasting impact on our life, none. You are not sowing to the Spirit, you're sowing to the world. And there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Hear that. He just loves you. He wants to spend time with you. He wants you to hear him. Take him at his word. Let that Ephesians 1 wash over you. I challenge each one of you. You get out your Bible and you white out those personal pronouns and put your name in there. Let him read his love letter to you. Start there. See, we're going after confidence here. The one thing that is so frightening about the church, the body of Christ, is our lack of confidence in him. It's frightening. We look around, almost afraid to say the name of Jesus. I don't think things are going to get any better, guys. You better start practicing now. And you know, it's like Pastor Todd said, because you don't have to stand on a street corner and start dragging people into your pickup truck. believe. That's not what you need to do. In fact, on the contrary, all you have to do is tell how Jesus is your best friend and why. He's become the lover of my soul. I know he has cared for me so many times. I don't want anything but him. This confidence is like a strong and trustworthy anchor for our souls. See, this is what anchors you to him. When you know how much he loves you, how much he cares for you, how much he wants to hear from you, how much time he wants to spend with you. But this will never happen if you don't slow yourself down and make time for him. You know how kids spell love? T-I-M-E. Yes. And I think God does too. The thing is, he's got all the time in the world. So he knows you have to set it aside to be with him. He's always available. He's never too busy. He wants to spend time with you. He knows how much margin you have. Hey, I was a single parent with two active kids. We had an incredibly busy schedule. But you know what? I can't imagine doing day without starting it with him. That was more important to me than life. One of my funniest stories was with my son when he was just a little guy, and he knew that mom always was up before him, and they were old enough to get ready for school and do that by themselves, so they just let me be with God in the morning. They knew I did my devotions in the morning and spent time praying for them. And it was funny because one morning, all of a sudden, I heard this boom, 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 boom. You know, they never really walk in the house, they run. And he did that, and he just burst through my doors, and he said, "Excuse me, God, Mom, the toilet's overflowing." And I got up real quick, and we went to take care of the mess and all of that. And it was, you know, a little bit of time later, I would reflect on that moment. And I would think, man, he's got good manners. He knew he interrupted God. But what a gift that moment was. It's made me smile all these years when I realized even your children know where your heart is. See, where's your heart? God wants your heart. He wants you. Your confidence comes from understanding God's favor. I think this is a really neat statement in your lesson, because I can honestly tell you that at this time in my life, I wasn't feeling a whole lot of God's favor as compared to a lot of other people. You know, we had an abbreviated family, very abbreviated. Now we were missing two people in our family. And so it was just me and my two children. And I remember thinking, gee, Lord, we really need more favor. We really do, if we're going to survive. And Romans 8:31 says, what can we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can be against us? And see, in this journey, God was teaching us that he would take care of us. Maybe it wouldn't be the world's way. I remember well-meaning people that really loved me, who got very angry at me when I would say things like, when they would say, well, what are you going to do? You're going to go back and finish the degree? What are you going to do when are you going to do all that? And I remember someone I love very much hanging up on me when I said, I'm living by faith and not by sight right now. I don't know what to do, but God will show me. Man, just hung up on me. I just didn't do what they wanted me to do. They didn't want me trusting. But see, God was teaching me that I was complete in him. And that he would show me my next steps. And he was faithful to do that. And I didn't get to where I am today in a straight line any more than the Israelites got into the promised land in a straight line. Okay, we talked about that, how that was an 11-day journey, but it took them 40 years. So God was teaching them along the way, just like he would start to teach me along the way. And he would start to, I was learning that he cared about my time with my children as much as I did, and that I was very concerned as a single parent that they wouldn't have enough time. And as I trusted him and walked things out with him, he was able to help me not only learn for me, but he was teaching me his protection and his provision all at the same time. We really were living by faith and not by sight. He was showing me that I was complete in him and that he was the lover of my soul. He loved my children even more than I did. That was hard to imagine at this point in my life. And yet he was showing me how he could provide, how he could make a way. You know, I'll never forget, I was very worried. Ben had just started school. He was just a little guy. And they had actually had a paper come home from the teacher, and I was thinking, oh my goodness, these children are only in first grade, and this there's bullying going on, and this thing's in first grade. And I remember asking our pastors at the time here, and I just said, please pray. I don't know what to do. I said, I'm very worried. I said, I had homeschooled Julie at this age, and so I thought, I don't have the ability the means to homeschool. So I really trusted that God was making a way for these children. And the amazing thing, long story short, was they just said, you know what, we're going to pray. And right after that, they just said, Linda, I got a phone call from the headmaster at a wonderful private Christian school. And he said, would you do us the honor of shadowing a class? And I thought, excuse me, but I can't afford your school. And he goes, we're not talking about that. He said, we would be honored if you would come and see if this would be a good fit for your son. And so I went, I just walked it out. And do you know, the amazing thing was I remember going to the public school at that point. And I had shadowed the class, and I was told that a full scholarship was his. All he had to do was take it. And I remember going to the public school, and the public school teacher stood there and cried. And I said, well, that letter came home, and I was worried about my son, and God just seemed to open up this door, and she just cried. And she goes, it wasn't about him. You know, she goes, you know what? He will be good there. And I said, I know it's God's plan for him. But she goes, he's one of my best students. And I thought, oh, but here God was taking him. He just used that for me, this mom, to trust. And of course, Ben did get a wonderful education, and I didn't worry that much about that, you see. That was just one story. I could tell you so many how God provided in all of this as I chose to just walk in my completeness with God. Did I shake? Yeah, I did. Was I scared? Sometimes. But what God was doing was he was retraining my mind. You got to remember, you're talking to someone who had had a child who was murdered. So I knew the world wasn't a friendly place. But I knew who God was. And God was retraining and refining so that when I would get afraid, I just said, if God is for me, who can be against me? Lord, you're the lover of my soul. Continue to just put your favor on me. And so as I began to embrace the truth of his word, now you've got some sheets on your table tonight, and I want to give you some. These were some that were handed to me back when I was going through all this. That's how long I've been using these. So I'm just using what God used for me. And that blue sheet there has 100 identity truths. You know what? We could write a lot more in there. But there are 100 identity truths that God tells you who you are to him. He's really serious about this, guys, even if you're not. He's gone way out of his way to tell you and write you love notes in his word. And if you're not opening his word, I can't make you. But these sheets, when you see them, you're going to see, and I want you to look them up, write them out. Use dry erase marker on your mirror, whatever it takes. Some of your table leaders will have ideas for you of what they've done over the years with their identity and get their minds reworked for him. You see, in 2 Corinthians, it says, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God. See, you don't have an excuse anymore. I'm taking it out from under you through God's word that you are enough. You are enough. And God wants to use you for his kingdom purposes. He will give you what you lack. That may be part of your journey, just asking him for more boldness or more courage. Do you know the bravest people in the world will tell you, no, I don't have the courage. God just gave it to me when I needed it. See, Jesus has worn everything for you. If you fully don't embrace what he has done, that's why this part is so important, that when he wore all you weren't on that cross, everything you lacked, everything base about you, he wore for you. In your journey, in this journey here on this earth, your journey, he's showing you how you're being refined as he drives the Maserati that's called your life. Okay. You only get one life, guys. You've got to make it count. And this is where I realized that I would one day have to meet my maker. You know, 46 years old, Bill got to meet his maker. God gave him those extra months to show him his grace and his mercy, prepare him for that time of meeting his Savior. I know where he is. I know where my son is. What God's been doing all along, though, for me, because I got left behind, I'm still here, was he was teaching me a renewed mind. And it's neat because I've met so many of you in this class and I've really enjoyed hearing some of your stories, but also realizing that many of you had the same kind of stinking thinking I did. And see, God wants to make our focus, our eyesight, 20/20 on him. He really wants to refine our focus. Romans 12:2, he says, "Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God." You may not know all of the points of what God's going to do with you, but I can tell you that this is where you've got to start. You've got to let him renew your mind so that you can experience the power of transformation, so that you can live in this world that is dark and scary and live it with light and life that speaks of him. People don't understand how you can be positive in a dark world. And yet that's who God was and is. We have to do the work in our minds. That's where you get to partner with him. You get to trust him. He grows you in your faith. And your will is able to make right choices when your mind is focused on the Spirit. You can't ride the fence anymore. You can't have one foot in the world and one foot in God. You can't. You'll go nowhere fast. You'll just be drift. You'll end up in the weeds. You will. That's what's going to happen. You're no longer unstable. Now you become stable. Your mind is set on God's truth, and his truth doesn't change. It colors, actually, everything in your world when you start to look at it through God's lens. Everything gets clearer. Isaiah 26:3 says, "You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, whose thoughts are fixed on you." I use that verse if I have any trouble sleeping at night. I just say it maybe 5 times and I'm back asleep. It's amazing how it works. But I learned how to do that, guys. This is a learned thing. I didn't come knowing how to do this. I learned to take God at his word. You can too. Do you ever hear the expression, you get out of it what you put into it? Okay, that's where we're at, guys. If you want to take your spiritual life seriously, then you are going to work it with him. You're just going to walk in step with him. Take him at his word in the simplest little things. I'm going to live by faith and not by sight. Lord, help me not to go to the right or to the left. Just keep me walking in the center of where you want me. You know, when I was praying for direction and knowing what to do next, I prayed for closed doors. And I'll tell you why I did. Because God makes a lot of open doors. But I always knew how not to bang my head on a closed door. And so I just prayed, Lord, just close the doors where I'm not supposed to go, and I'll just keep walking. And you know what? It'll work for you. I know it will, because that's how God works. He said, just want you to keep working. Don't give up. Just keep walking in the path that he set you. Maybe it's just for these next few weeks, you just keep coming back to class. Let God teach you in this journey. Learn to hear from him. Do you realize how valuable that is if that's all you get out of these classes? To hear from God? To be encouraged to hear? And that can come in the way of any way that Scripture is spoken. In our world, it could come through, you know, airwaves. We've got cell phones, we've got internet, we've got songs. But capture it. sing it over and over again. Maybe you've got a song that's just in your head all the time. Take a minute, really listen to it. Maybe God's speaking to you through the lyrics of it. Maybe it's not just a tune, okay? Slow down. Some of you, maybe your minds race. One of the best places to learn to slow down is to go to the beach. And I'll tell you, it's very difficult to do, but I challenge you to just listen to the waves when you get there. The minute you get out of the car, even if you park in a parking lot, and you go there, just tune your ear to the waves. Do you know how quickly your thought life is going to throw that out? It's very difficult to do. But it's fun when people take me at my word and do this. I've had really funny phone calls or texts. 45 seconds, Linda, I did it. I know they're down on the beach. They're just trying to quiet their mind so that they can hear from God. This is where the battlefield is waged between your ears. Next week, as we continue on this, we're going to talk a lot about decision making. Okay, making right choices. And that's going to take place right here. But we have to get this in place where at least you're listening to God more than you're listening to the world. We have to refine our focus. Can you see that? You catching that? I hope so. Because this world will scream at you. It will always, you can't even go down in your car without having billboards and all these kinds of things coming at you. Where is your mind? And I hope it's set on things above. But you have to do that. You have to surround yourself with the good, with the true, with the pure, with the lovely. Think on these things. You have to put that information in to get it out.